Last week, we looked at the Book of Judges. Book of Judges, Sefer Shoftim, really took us to maybe the ugliest point in Jewish history, where you have, you start off with a sort of a fragmented tribal system, where Deborah has trouble coalescing all of the tribes, and then we come to the absolute nadir of Jewish existence, when the Jewish people engage in a full-scale civil war between the people of Benjamin and the people of the rest of the tribes. And if you recall the story that we saw was the story of Pelegish Begiva. This is a story where there was essentially the abuse of a woman, the I'll call it politely, the girlfriend of this traveler. And after she is unfortunately abused violently, essentially raped all night, he finds her dead body. Someone in the chat last week said, you know, how come he didn't check on her the whole night? And I think that's a legitimate criticism, that all sorts of appropriate behavior were completely abandoned. But he's so angry that he cuts her body up, sends it around to the rest of the tribes. And this is the spark for a civil war. You can see that this book clearly is showing us that the bottom has fallen out, and there needs to be a wholesale change. And the wholesale change is, in fact, the story of the monarchy. There are many who say that the Book of Shoftim was written by the prophet Shmuel, and the prophet Shmuel is the prophet who is the kingmaker. He is the first to bring Saul into the picture, and then ultimately David. We are going to skip Saul because this is the sweep of Jewish history, and unfortunately, Saul got swept onto the cutting floor of this because I'm trying to cover ground, so we're going to go straight to David. Now, David, of course, is famous. What's that a picture of?
David and Goliath.
Very good. David and Goliath. So, first of all, whoever did this version of David and Goliath got it wrong, because what's wrong in that picture?
Wasn't a spear.
Yeah, wasn't a spear. So that's, first of all, the problem. But the question is, who is David and how does he come to power? So he comes to power by volunteering to take King Saul's place. And essentially, as is perhaps well known, is in the ancient world, you could have two armies line up and they could fight it out to the death and tens of thousands of people could die. Or you could have a challenge of champions. We'll just let our best guy fight your best guy, and whoever wins, that it is that person who wins the battle. And so this is exactly what happens. Goliath challenges the Goliath and the Philistines challenge the Israelites led by Saul to a battle of champions. And in this battle of champions, David is going to engage Saul's the king. He's the champion. He's the one who's supposed to go out there. But he is a little bit afraid. And so what ends up happening is David offers to take his place. And ultimately, Saul even offers David his armor. It's a very symbolic moment where Saul is essentially ceding his role as king. He's abdicating, if you will, abdicates the throne or the royal armor, gives it to David. And David takes on this champion, Goliath. Now, what's interesting about the story of David and Goliath has recently been made famous by Malcolm Gladwell, is Goliath may have suffered from gigantism. Now, this is, and Jonathan Leipzig is still on the line, so he can tell us what this is. Gigantism is when you have a pituitary gland, which is, for the sake of the annotation, pituitary gland over here is going to press upon the optic nerve, and it creates a whole slew of symptoms. What are some of the symptoms? Well, first of all, this is from a researcher at UCLA. This is on the right-hand side. You see, I hope it's on your right-hand side. You see the researcher's hand, and on the left-hand side, you see the pituitary tumor, and the result is gigantism. Hopefully you can you can see the difference between the two hands, right? So if you will, on the right is David's hand and on the left is Goliath's hand. But as well, one of the things which is a feature of this is there's a loss of peripheral vision. And often in many patients, there is there's double vision. And so the argument here is that David was able to defeat Goliath because David understood that his opponent had some significant disadvantages in the battle. He looked very imposing. He was someone who would create lots of fear. You would quake in your boots if you saw this guy. And who could possibly beat him? But I think part of what is perhaps the genius here is that David understands his enemy quite well. And David understands what you really need. The presentation in the Torah is very much a presentation of faith. That David basically says, look, that Hashem is going to help me win this battle. It is Hashem who is the master of all battles. Lev Melachim Biyad Hashem, the heart of kings is in the hand of God. And he brings that trust into the battle. But I think that the association between the nimble David and the slow but enlarged Goliath is one which is sort of interesting and worth noting. Only in that I think it brings a little bit, I like the things that make these stories closer to real. They make you be able to feel and touch them, make them very tangible. And this understanding of the story of David and Goliath, to me, makes it all that more tangible. The real story of David and Goliath is not the miracle of the story, in my opinion, as much as David's bravery in confronting this figure and him showing up Shaul and his willingness to be the rightful king and his willingness to put himself at risk in front of the entire people of Israel. That's really the story of David. Now, what happens next is King Saul is jealous and he makes David into a fugitive. And Saul mismanages the situation. The Spirit of God leaves him, at least so the Bible tells us. And he dies on the battlefield against the Philistines, cutting out many, many fascinating, interesting stories, subplots in this whole bit. But you need to know how Saul comes to an end. He commits suicide, asking his armor bearer to kill him. This is a fascinating story because this is one of the stories of suicide in the Bible. And it is one of the stories that the rabbis will ultimately use to justify certain kinds of scenarios, maybe like Masada, for example, where suicide might be warranted. Whole other topic, not really for us, just teasing you with the fact that that is part of the story of Saul. David succeeds then against other enemies such as Amalek in the south at the same time. And ultimately there is a war between the followers of David and the followers of Shaul. David's followers do prevail, but it should be noted that David and his general Yoab and his brothers, the B'nai Tzuria, you forgive the typo, the little zero at the end of brothers was meant to be a close paren. They endure a protracted civil war with the remaining sons of Shaul. And then David establishes his capital in Hebron. And then David captures Jerusalem. And David moves his capital from Hebron to Jerusalem. Now, I want to, at this point, press pause on the story of David, and I want to press play on the story of Jerusalem. Now, before we press play on the story of Jerusalem, you can take yourselves off mute if you know, is Jerusalem mentioned in the five books of Moses?
Is it mentioned as Shalem?
It is mentioned as Ir Shalem, a very good Audrey. When Abraham returns from his commando raid to rescue his nephew Lot, he meets Malki Tzedek in a city which is called Shalem. Many people say that that's Jerusalem. Yes, true. But I'm looking for a mention as Yerushalayim, exactly those words. So the answer is no. It is not mentioned in the five books of Moses. So let's play the prices right now. How many times is Jerusalem mentioned in Tanakh, in the Hebrew Bible? I'm taking numbers. I'll even look in, let me see if I can look in the chat. Okay, nobody's even putting it in the chat. Unmute yourselves, give me a number.
Five,
okay, I have, what's that? So I have, here, hold on a second. So here are my numbers right now. I've got five, okay? Another, Stan and Nora have 300. Okay. All right. Anybody else?
500.
Okay. The real number is, everyone? 641.
Wow.
That's closest.
This is rather profound that we have zero mentions in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, or Bereishit, Shemot, Vayikra, Bamidbar, and Dvarim, but we had 641 mentions in the rest of Tanakh. That's a very, very significant difference. So our question that we're going to have to ask now is, why is it not mentioned? Why is Jerusalem not mentioned in the rest of the Bible? So I want you to stay tuned on that one, because we are moving forward on with a little bit more of the story of Jerusalem. So before, let's talk about before Jerusalem. Oops, undo that. Let's talk about before Jerusalem. Before Jerusalem, there was a Mishkan. So the Mishkan was this traveling sanctuary that went around the desert with the Jews. You have a picture of it there. It's described in the Parshiot of Terumah, Tetzaveh, Kitisa, Vayakel, Pekudei. There's more information, more detail, more verbiage dedicated to the construction of the Mishkan than any other subject in the rest of the Bible. So this was a very important piece, and it is central to the entire Jewish experience. So this Mishkan, it travels with the Jews in the desert for 39 years. It then resides in Shiloh for 370 years. Well, actually, it starts, I skipped Gilgal. Gilgal, so again, desert is there for 39 years. Then it is in Gilgal for 14 years. So when Joshua crosses the Jordan, the Mishkan is set up in Gilgal, and it stays there for 14 years. During the entire period of the book of Joshua, that's where the Mishkan is. Then the Mishkan goes up to Shiloh, and it's there for 370 years. And then the Mishkan moves to the cities of Nov and Givon. And it is in the cities of Nov and Givon for, I believe, 57 years. The Talmud in Masechet Zvachim tells us that the Mishkan was in Shiloh for approximately 369, 370 years, and in Nov and Givon for 57 years. And so it was in Israel for 440 years before Solomon builds the temple. And so when Solomon builds the first temple, circa 1000 BCE, that's 480 years after the Exodus. So we're at 2020. So if we went back 480 years ago, so who was living 480 years ago? So 480 years ago was roughly, I think we're talking roughly the expulsion of the Jews from Spain, right? 1492, does that more or less get me to 2020? So that's the amount of time between the Exodus from Egypt and the building of the temple. That's just a little bit of context for the Mishkan that was there before there was a temple in Jerusalem. Now let's talk a bit about the conquest in Jerusalem. Now, in front of you, you see a schematic of the walls of Jerusalem. What is fascinating here is that this schematic tells you a lot, and it is something that you can actually walk today. So over on the top left of your screen, you see that little patch of dirt in the top left? I'll circle it for you. That top left is probably just due south of the Eastern Wall. The edge of, maybe it's the southeast corner of the Beit HaMikdash, of the Temple Mount. And then, so you're essentially, if you're moving in this direction, you're heading towards the Mount of Olives. Here's the Kidron Valley over here. The Kidron Valley, and you, the right here is the Gihon Spring. The Gihon Spring is the water source that is the water source for all of Jerusalem. And there are various natural shafts that exist in this area. You'll see right here the vertical shaft, and then a horizontal tunnel. These are natural features of Jerusalem in the days of David and his general Yoav. Now, I'm going to shift now. I'm going to take you to a little YouTube video, hopefully this all works out well. I'm hoping that you'll be able to see this. Somebody let me know in the chat if this does not work well. Okay, do you see a picture of a lyre? Is that up for you guys? Yeah. Okay, here goes the movie. Watch the movie.
About 3,000 years ago, David, son of Jesse, is crowned king of Israel. This is the beginning of the royal house of David. David decides that Jerusalem, positioned at the heart of the Israelite territory, will be the capital of his kingdom. But Jerusalem is a powerful and intimidating Canaanite city, and until David's time, no tribe has been able to conquer it. Now, once again, confident of their fortifications, the Jebusites take up positions on the city walls. The young King David challenges the complacent enemy. He is determined. This time, Jerusalem must fall.
אני עומד על המדרון המזרחי של עיר דוד. כאן, בשנת 1995, מצאו הארכיאולוגים פרופסור רוני רייך ואלי שוקון שרידים של מגדל ענק שנבנה על ידי הכנענים לפני כ-4,000 שנה. האבנים האלה, שכל אחת מהן שוקלת מספר רב של טונות, הן חלק ממגדל עצום שנבנה ממש כאן בסמוך למעיין הגיחון.
You shall not come in here! The Jebusites mock David. They station blind and lame men on the city walls. The message is clear. The city is so strong that even the blind and the lame can easily defend it.
David מבין שבדרכים מקובלות הוא לא יצליח לכבוש את העיר. הוא צריך לחשוב מחוץ לקופסה. שלו כבר נרקמת מזימה.
You can't see the translation?
Only the title screen.
Okay. All right. Boy. All right. Well, okay. So here's what we're going to do.
We're not seeing an actual video.
Okay. Then, I'm discovering the limits of the platform. Okay. So here's what we're going to do. It's a very neat video, but I will have to, put it in a link here. And I'm going to go back to my, PowerPoint. Okay. And hopefully you are okay. Hopefully the PowerPoint is in front of you. You see that schematic of Jerusalem? Yes, okay. So here, I am going to... maybe I should have looked up how to show a YouTube video on Zoom to everyone, but all right, here is a link to this video. So people can, you can go after we finish, you can go to this video and see exactly what it was all about, and appreciate what, on your own times and probably better resolution than I could give you over Zoom, you'll be able to appreciate this, this particular video. What the video does for you is it takes you to something that you can walk through today. Well, maybe not today, but please God, in a few months, you can go back there. And when people tell me they go to Jerusalem and they say, I said, did you go to the tunnel tours? They always tell me, yeah, I went to the tunnel tours. I said, which tunnel tours did you go to? They said, oh, we went to the Western Wall tunnels. I said, you went to the wrong tunnel tour. Why do I say they went to the wrong tunnel tour? Because the Western Wall tunnels are not really tunnels. They're tunnels because we have decided that we're not going to ruin thousands of homes, and we're not going to completely blast through maybe several millennia of strata. And they simply just dig along the what would have been the Roman pathway of the I guess the western side of the Western Wall. And so you can walk along that and you can see what it would have been like to somebody walking that Roman era. But that is all Second Temple period. I'm much more interested in the First Temple period. And there's a tunnel tour of the First Temple period. The tunnel tour of the First Temple period takes you through the area that we were just talking about. This, it takes you through the these tunnels that you see here. Now there is an additional tunnel that exists nowadays. The schematic, as I mentioned before, that is a schematic that was true in the days when David HaMelech was there. But now there's another tunnel, and I'm sort of roughing out where that other tunnel is. That other tunnel is the tunnel of Chizkiyahu. Hold on, let me mute everyone because somebody's giving me feedback here. Okay, hopefully the sound is better now. I'm not getting that feedback. Okay, so this little tunnel that I have put there is full of, is carries water from the Gihon Spring into central Jerusalem. It was a very, very important feature that allowed King Chizkiyahu in a much later date to survive a Babylonian siege, an Assyrian siege. And you can walk through that tunnel, and it's amazing to walk through the tunnel. You go there, you take a pair of water sandals, and you walk through. You can see the little etching on the wall that where they says that this is where the two sides met. They dug from two different directions. This is around the year, let's say 750. There were tunnelers tunneling from two separate directions. That is a hard feat to do in 2020, but it is a almost miraculous feat back then. But I'm digressing because I'm not really supposed to be telling the story of Chizkiyahu. I want to tell you the story of David. And so this, what you're seeing here, you can literally walk through this. I can't emphasize that enough, that you can walk through those areas and you can see how David and Yoav penetrated the tunnel. And what happens is the Yebusi, the Jebusites, are so certain that their city is impregnable that they put essentially cripples on the walls. And David and Yoav, specifically Yoav, climbs the vertical shaft that you have here and then enters the city through this tunnel. How he knows about the tunnel, I don't know. But he has good intel, and he is able to enter the city through the tunnel. He is then able to unlock the gates. David and his forces, they conquer Jerusalem. That is how Jerusalem is conquered. It is conquered from a people who were exceptionally cruel, who were essentially, put their lepers up to be, to to be mocked by any potential invading army. Okay, now, so David conquers Jerusalem. Great. This is what Jerusalem looks like in the time of David. The city is down here, the major part of the city, and the upper part of the city is more or less unused. But over here up top, this is the threshing floor. And the reason you would put the threshing floor up at the top is because you want to catch the wind. I don't know how many people have been in Jerusalem recently, but it can, especially in the evening, it can become quite windy. And there's a threshing floor up here that belonged to somebody who was named Arnava Yevusi. Someone, a Jebusite whose name was Arnava. He's not necessarily that important to the story. But what is important actually is the next piece of the story. And that really, the next piece of the story is really what becomes the key to the whole picture. And that is that this threshing floor, why am I not moving forward? Hold on. Having trouble with the technology. Oh, I know why I'm having trouble with the technology. Okay. This is now the Jerusalem you have here. Now, I want to go back so that you see this very clearly. There's the threshing floor. You see the temple is built on the threshing floor? If you can see that. Put your thumbs up so I can know that that's what's going on. Okay, good, Maddie, thank you. So now the temple is built on this threshing floor. What's so important about that? Well, I'll tell you what's important about that, is that David unifies the 12 tribes and he buys this area for 600 shekel from Arnava Yevusi. 50 shekel per tribe times 12 tribes, that is 600 shekel. 50 times 12, 600. This is the key to the whole picture. When David establishes a capital, remember that David's capital used to be where? Somebody unmute yourself, tell me where David's capital used to be.
Betel?
What? Sorry?
Betel?
No, not Betel. Hebron. Other direction. Hebron. It used to be in Hebron. Hebron is solidly in the territory of Yehuda. Where does Jerusalem sit? Which tribe's territory does that sit in?
Nobody's.
Correct.
It was in the middle between all of them.
It's Ben Ketefav Shachem. It sits in between the shoulders. Jerusalem's topography is very interesting. Jerusalem's topography is that it is surrounded by five mountains, and it is the lowest mountain amongst them. And there is a whole debate in the Talmud about whether it belongs only to the tribe of Benjamin or whether a little bit of it belongs to Judah. But the Tanakh doesn't have any issue with it whatsoever. Tanakh is clear. This is a city that belongs to everyone because it belongs to no one. And you'll see that the way David sets up the holiest site in Jerusalem, remember that Mishkan had traveled around for many, many years, and it had sat in the north. It had sat in the area of the children of Leah, of sort of, we'll call it Rachel-esque, I'm sorry, the children of Rachel, Ephraim. It had been in Rachel-esque territory for a long time. If you divide the tribes up between their two mothers, Rachel and Leah, so the north area is dominated by Joseph's children. Those are all Rachel's children, of course. And it spent 400 years there. Now you have King David trying to unify all of these people. And so he moves the capital from his own territory, from Judah territory, into no man's land. He has to conquer a new city that is not owned by any of the tribes, that was left unconquered. And then he, in a very symbolic act, he ensures that the holiest site in the entirety of the Israelite kingdom is going to be owned by everyone. And what also interesting, by the way, is that The Talmud says Yerushalayim lo nitchalka lishvatim. Jerusalem was not divided amongst the tribes, which means that no one can really own property in Jerusalem. It's all, what do they call it, land lease or leasehold, right? People have they sort of rent it, I guess, from the Jewish people. So this to me is a very fascinating scenario. I would one day love to see what happens when I go into the Jerusalem Citadel Museum and try to tell them that it's my ancestral right to be able to reside in their hotel for free. I've never actually tried that trick. I'm sure, I have a feeling it's not going to work terribly well. The last thing I just want to show you here is has nothing to do with the rest. It's just, I was so fascinated by this. The spring tower that guards the Gihon spring is 23 feet thick. That is pretty serious tower. So David and Yoav, again, they overcome the odds by seeing beyond the obvious. So I think there is something about David and Yoav that they are able to see things that other people don't. So now we go back to our original question. Is Jerusalem mentioned in the five books of Moses? And the answer is no, it's not. And so we ask, why is it not mentioned in the five books of Moses? And the answer is it has a modern parallel, Washington, D.C. So Washington, D.C., if my mother is still on, she should wave. There she is. My mother's waving. It's always good to know that you have at least one friendly participant. Washington, D.C. Sits in no state of the union. There was a law that they didn't want people selling T-shirts. They didn't want to give licenses to people to sell T-shirts on the mall in Washington, D.C. But there was a big court case because there were some of these T-shirt vendors would sell the T-shirt D.C., the 51st state. And since that was a political opinion, they had a lot of trouble making a law not selling that. I go to tell you the story of T-shirt vendors because Washington, D.C. is meant not to be a part of any state. Because if you, anybody know where the capital of the United States used to be? Before Washington?
Philadelphia.
Philadelphia.
Philadelphia. And I think for a time, even New York City was a contender. New York City gets enough attention anyway. You don't need the capital of the country being there. Everybody else is going to feel like a stepchild. And so you want the place, which is the capital of the country, to be something which has equal access to all tribes. And so that is why Jerusalem is not mentioned in the five books of Moses, but it is mentioned so many times in the rest of the Bible. And because if it had been mentioned, there would be jealousy and fighting over which tribe owns the capital. As I mentioned before, by the way, the Talmud, the operating principle in Jerusalem is unity. There's no tribe that owns Jerusalem. And as I said, Yerushalayim lo nitchalka lishvatim, that Jerusalem is not divided amongst the tribes. And here you can see there are many different gates to Jerusalem. And I think that the symbolism of the many different gates to Jerusalem is something which will remind us that the great genius, I think, of King David is that he is able to actually achieve the unity that was once envisioned. If you started last week with the story of Deborah and her feeling abandoned by the tribe of Reuven, or you took it all the way to the end and saw the bitter battle that took place between the tribe of Benjamin and the tribe and the other 11 tribes, you see that you were at the nadir, the high point of disunity. Well, David successfully builds a city that remains the center of the Jewish people, not just during the entirety of the First Temple period and then into the Second Temple period, but it remains the beating heart of the center of the Jewish people for till today. And just a sort of an interesting piece of the puzzle. What does the word Yerushalayim mean?
City of peace.
City of peace. Yes.
Yerushalayim,
I assume that means city of peace because you drop the ayin. The Hebrew word for city is as follows. Let me just get my, oops. The Hebrew word for city is as follows. It is ayin, yud, resh. So that ayin, sometimes ayins fall away. So if that ayin falls away, so these two letters that are left could really have been Yerushalayim, the city of peace. Okay, fine. I'm willing to go that far. But I think that it was more important in many ways is not just the fact of peace, but what does this root also mean?
A whole.
Whole, right? The idea is that this is the city that makes the all the parts whole. And if you ask me, what is the great genius? If we're looking at a very, very macro level, we're asking ourselves, what is the great contribution of King David to the political history of the Jewish people? The answer is he's the one who really creates a unified picture. And this happens after a very bitter and long drawn out civil war between the followers of David and the followers of Shaul. So between Yehuda and Benjamin. And David successfully creates this peace bridge. And the city itself is that peace bridge which holds the whole picture together. And it remains that way. It remains a place of peace. It remains a cornerstone for the entire Jewish people. I should also mention here that one of the things that is interesting about Jerusalem is that it became a place where people's confidence was such that if Jerusalem stood, then that meant God was with the Jewish people. And that if Jerusalem stood, then there was no way for them to be vanquished because God would not destroy his city. We have many miles to go before we get to that point, because first we have to have Solomon built the temple, and then we have to have several very miraculous victories that will generate that idea. Now, I just want to show you something else. As I was looking over this and trying to just brush up a little bit, I found this was something that came up last week. People asked me what other bula have been found in Jerusalem. So this is an article that was published the year I started high school, 1986, by Yigal Shiloh. And all of these bula were found in the city of David. Now just going back, just so you know where the city of David is. So the city of David is this area right here. This is what's being excavated, right? This is before you get to the temple, which then goes on top of that, right? So the city of David is this area over here. There are many fascinating excavations that are happening there right now. And these bula were all found there. Now this to me is something every Jew should know, because there's lots of challenges that say, oh, you guys are conquerors, you guys are colonialists, you're really European colonialists, you have no real connection. So in Ir David, what was found? So these bula, as I mentioned last week, they're all written in Paleo Hebrew, or what's called Ktav Ivri in the Talmud. And this one right here, oh, hold on. You'll forgive me, I'm still learning to use the platform. So this one right here is it says Legamaryahu ben Shafan. So first of all, Hebrew speakers, what was his father's name? So Gemaryahu ben Shafan. So this name, Shafan, what does it mean?
A rabbit.
A rabbit. I love it. I love it. They used to name people rabbit. If you look at the Tanakh, there are people who are named camel, there are people named horsey, there are people, all these names. There's so many. What's that?
Alba Savua. Alba Savua.
Right, right, okay. But that's a Talmudic
figure.
Right. And I'm not sure he's really named that. But okay, well, he was called the dog. I think that might have been a nickname for him. You know, like Mad Dog Mattis, which I think he never liked that name either. So sometimes people get named different things. But I love the fact that that they named him Dog, a rabbit. So his name is Rabbit. And this guy, Gemariahu ben Shafan, is actually a real character in Tanakh. He is the scribe to Jeremiah. When Jeremiah writes the book of Lamentations, it's actually Gemariahu ben Shafan who puts it to paper, and he at the book, the original copy of the book of Lamentations is thrown into the fire by King Jehoiakim, and he ignores the dire warnings of this, and Gemariahu ben Shafan protests against this. We see this individual Gemariahu ben Shafan as a close confidant of Jeremiah. And literally, you can say, I see the image. This may be in the Israel Museum right now. I could go and touch the bula. The bula was his stamp. This was how he sealed his letters. And so this is, to me, is just a fascinating thing. I can't really even contain my excitement about it, because again, just like the story of David and Goliath, the more these stories become things that I can walk through, the story of the tunnel, the more they become the things that I can see in a museum, the more those people who would say this book is not, the Bible is a nice storybook, it isn't. It is the story of our people. And I find such an enormous connection to Torah, to Judaism, by knowing that A, this is the story of my family, B, knowing that it goes back 4,000 years, and C, knowing that there are physical pieces of this story that literally jump out of the ground. Okay, so we are now going to pause the story of Jerusalem, and we are going back to this story of David. Now, the story of David is filled, as beautiful as it was, as nice a story as I told, maybe as inspiring as you're willing to say it is, that the story of David is the story of the unification of the Jewish people. Now we're coming to the point that the story of David is also going to be about a warning. And Samuel has a warning at the beginning of, in the middle of the book of Samuel 1, chapter 8, is a worthwhile chapter for everybody to read. It is fundamental political philosophy. This is what Samuel says. This is the, he said, you know, people want a king. Okay, but beware. This is the practice of the king who will rule over you. He will take your sons and appoint them as his charioteers and horsemen, and they will serve as outrunners for his chariots. He will appoint them as his chiefs of thousands and of fifties, or they will have to plow his fields, reap his harvest, and make his weapons and the equipment for his chariots. He will take your daughters as perfumers, as cooks and bakers. He will seize your choice fields, vineyards, and olive groves and give them to his courtiers. He will take a tenth part of your grain and vintage and give it to his eunuchs and courtiers. He will take a tenth part of your flocks and you shall become his slaves. So this is Shmuel HaNavi. In the last book, we can say that he advocated for the need for a king. But even as he makes the kings, he's giving this dire warning that they are going to abuse power. And you can make the argument that the rest of the books of Shmuel and Malachim are all about Shmuel HaNavi's study of how it is that that power was abused. And so I will leave you with a teaser for next. It's not going to be next week, because next week we're going to be doing Jewish history, but you're going to be doing it with matzah and maror. So I won't be doing it over Zoom. But I guess it will be maybe in the middle of Pesach. Maybe probably after Pesach. I'm not sure of the date, so I'll have to clarify that. But the teaser is, once again, Leonard Cohen. You saw her bathing on the roof. Her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. So We will be exploring the inspiration for those lines in our next session. So I'm happy to open up if there are questions. You can throw them into the chat or unmute yourselves.
Thank you. Thank you, Rabbi Yasher Koch. That was great.
Okay, that wasn't a question.
It's not a question. I don't want to make you blush in front of your mom, but you're such a gift for our community and such a blessing. Thank you so much.
Pleasure. Nobody else has any questions?
Yes, Toda Rabba. So what Shmuel says, it's a bit disturbing. Was it warning or was it how Yif foresaw it, or was it what he saw that David HaMelech was about to do, keeping all the people of Israel and his slaves?
Well, I would say that it is, he knows that Shmuel is very keenly aware of the abuses of power. And you can make the argument that the reason Shmuel is very aware of the abuses of power is because Shmuel grows up in the Mishkan, in the Beit HaMikdash, in the days of the corruption of Shiloh. If you read the beginning of the book of Shmuel, you learn about the corruption of the priests of Shiloh. And Rabbi Soloveitchik says that on Tisha B'Av, there's actually a kina, there's a lamentation for the fall of Shiloh. And he says that is the forgotten destruction. People don't remember that at Shiloh, where the temple was for 390 years, at the time of the high priest whose name was Eli, his two sons were essentially abusing women and stealing sacrifices. The Talmud tries to mitigate what they were doing, and the Talmud says that their abuse was relatively minor. This is a sort of a motif of one, at least one opinion in the Talmud that tries to say that the sins were minimal, but even so, they were worthy of great punishment. Others would say that, you know, the Yehuda Kiel in the Dat Mikra, I think, says that the reason that they stole their meat with a three-pronged fork was because a two-pronged was not strong enough to hold up the weight of the meat. And so there was some serious corruption. So Shmuel grows up in the lap of corruption, at least religious corruption in the Beit HaMikdash. And so he understands what power means. And so I think he's basically saying, you want a king, just beware what power does to people. And I don't know whether Shmuel knew, maybe he had nevuah, maybe he had prophecy that let him see this, but the nevuah is his premonition will apply to elements of the story of David, elements of the story of Shlomo, elements of the story of Rechavam. It will go on and on and on and on. And so Shmuel's read is a characterological read, which is deep into humanity. And so I think that I wouldn't place it per se on David or Shlomo, but rather in the potential character flaw. One of those about stealing a vineyard is going to take place much, much later on in a king who's Ahab. But we have many miles to go before that.
Yeah.
Rabbi.
Yes.
Why do you think Shmuel was able to allow a king? I mean, wouldn't Hashem intervene and say, you know, that's, you know, I don't allow it?
I think it's a lesser of evils, quite honestly. If you look at how bad things were during the book of Shoftim, you're willing to stomach a little bit of abuse on the part of a king so that you keep everybody together and you create a moral center. Jerusalem becomes a place where people will regularly come for their devotions, for their religious necessities. It will become a place of sharing. It will become a place of learning. It will become a place of national unity. It has many, many, many beneficial effects in terms of the way society operated. And I'm trying to figure out exactly how and when I'll be giving the Shabbat HaGadol Drasha, but one of my colleagues planted a great idea in my head, which was that after the destruction of the first of the second Beit HaMikdash, everybody used to go to Jerusalem for their Seder, right? They used to go, they bring their Passover offering to the Beit HaMikdash, to the temple. They would slaughter it there, and they would have to eat it in Jerusalem. So when the Beit HaMikdash was destroyed, that's when the Seder was born. That's the Seder as you know it was born, right? This book called the Haggadah, which we have, which includes lots of things about people after the temple was destroyed, the way in which that happens, right? It says, Zeichel Mikdash Kehillel. This is in memory of the way that the Seder was observed in the times of Hillel. Well, Hillel wasn't saying in memory of the way I did it last year. That's how he did it. So we have this scenario where the old package, the package of the Seder as Jerusalem, ended, and the Seder in your home began. So this my colleague who was suggesting this as a topic basically said, this year's Seder is a game-changing Seder. It changes the rhythm of almost everybody's Seder. And so it gives us an opportunity to investigate this idea of these kinds of changes. Why did I get into this whole picture? I got into this whole picture because Stan asked me, well, why would God allow this for the king to happen if it had negative outcomes? And I guess it's a risk-benefit analysis. And the risk is that if you didn't have a king, if you didn't bring people together, you would ultimately end up in a state of permanent civil war and moral degradation.